Open it up to Matthew 24. And I'm going to ask you to keep the lights on for just a little bit, brother, if you will, and then as we read some passages. Matthew chapter 24. And I want to start reading at verse 1. These were the Lord's words nearly 2,000 years ago. I don't know how many of you have ever taken the time to read God's Word, but if you've studied it very much, you know that there are hundreds and hundreds of passages that refer to the second coming of Jesus Christ and the end of the world. And this is probably one of the most asked questions, especially among young people. There's probably not a person here that doesn't know what the future, or doesn't desire to know what the future holds. And this book says that God holds the future. Amen. And things that are happening in our society, interesting enough, are pointing to what is not the end of the world, but according to the scripture, the end of the age. This world is at least going to be around 1,007 years. It's not going to explode in a nuclear holocaust and disappear out of the universe, according to the Bible. But we are seeing the world come to an end as we know it, this social system. And it says in verse 1, "And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down." About 40 years after that statement, Titus moved in and absolutely ripped Jerusalem apart. And oddly enough, somebody mentioned to him that they believed that there was gold hidden between the stones of the temple. And so they took oxen and pulled every single stone from off another, hoping to find some hidden treasure. Jesus said not one stone would be upon another. And this destruction of Jerusalem was predicted. The scripture, if you go in other places, said that that crushing of Jerusalem would be a final blow until once again God would bring the nation of Israel back together. And that that generation that seen this happen wouldn't pass away till all things be fulfilled. And for those of you that do not know this, that May 14th, 1948, Israel fulfilled a prophecy that's well over 3,000 years old. It said it would once again become a nation, which places that generation that's born from 1948 on into a very interesting position according to the scripture. But it says in verse 3, "And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be? What shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world?" Now there's three questions there. When will these things be? Number one, what is the sign of your coming, and when is the end of the world? Or the sign of the end of the world. Verse 4, "Jesus answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you." So obviously, brother, for Jesus to say, be very careful, nobody deceives you, that means that there are going to come in the last days very convincing deception. And that deception is going to be like this. Verse 5, "For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. You shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There shall be famines." What do you see on a weekend, an average late night on Saturday night or Sunday programming? It's famine relief. And the Bible says there'll be famines and there shall be pestilences. Do you understand that? That's not just talking about like locusts and that type of thing, but it's dealing with diseases. And folks, do you understand we are really at a very serious, crucial time in our history? With the AIDS epidemic, we could literally be dead, every person off this planet dead within the next 40 years. That's what scientists and these men are telling us. And there shall be earthquakes. How many saw in the paper, front page news today? Another major earthquake in diverse places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Now the scripture marks at the last day, and if you were here last night, we talked about this, that it would be a day, or it would be a time of intense hardships. I mean, folks, understand the weather pattern is not surprising to God. And the Bible makes it clear that there's going to be strange events that's going to take place on the planet. And it goes on to say, then they shall deliver you up to be afflicted, shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended. Now listen, and keep in mind what's happening in the church within the last week and what's happened in the church within the last year and a half. Many shall be offended, many shall betray one another, shall hate one another. False prophets shall rise, shall deceive many. And listen to this, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many will wax cold. And what's so scary about all this, I'm seeing teenagers that are too young to have a hard heart, that are becoming hardened in their heart. And the reason why is because iniquity abounds. Not just iniquity in the world, but iniquity in the church, folks. And because iniquity is abounding, the Bible says the love of many will wax cold. Now let's skip down to verse 21. I don't have time to read the whole chapter. I wish we did. Then, verse 21, same chapter, then shall there be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor shall ever be. And except those days be shortened, there shall be no flesh saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. Jesus said, this tribulation, these hard, difficult times will bring the world to nothing almost. Verse 23, then if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ. Now remember that, and you'll see why in just a few minutes when we get on our slides. Lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not. For there shall arise false Christ. Now remember that. And false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, even so much if it were possible they shall deceive the very elect. Behold, I have told you before. Let's see. Let's skip down to verse 35. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. But of that day and hour knoweth no man. No, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man be. And I wish we had time to read on. We just simply don't. You need to, when you get home tonight, take a time and read that whole chapter. It's great. Brother, let's go ahead and bring those lights down. I don't know how many of you keep up on stuff like this. I'm not a real avid reader of books. I think if I have much time at all, I just like to spend my time reading the Word. But I find it interesting that this book, now this is the tape that goes along with the book. This is a book that has been a New York Times bestseller. It was written by a man who is a expert in economics. This man has studied, what do you call people that study economics? Yeah, that's pretty easy, I guess. Economics. But he's an expert in this realm. This man predicted, now not spiritually predicted, like a psychic or something, but through observations and study of trends, the market and such thing, he predicted the collapse in October, made it public, months in advance. Wrote a lot of interesting stuff. There was a whole article, article on his studies in some of the big magazines, nationwide magazines. And he's been on Phil Donahue and some of the other talk shows. Dr. Ravi Batra, who has studied this thing and has predicted that 1990 will be the collapse of the money system for America. Now, this is something that men talk about who don't have any kind of preference to, biblical references at all. They're just saying that the way our economy is going, it is inevitable that this is going to fall again. Now, this man says it's going to happen in 1990. It's almost Everybody you talk to today, they kind of talk like something's getting ready to come to happen. I mean, no matter who they are, whether they're an atheist or a believer, there's kind of like this feeling that everybody's got that something's about ready to transpire. Now, it's kind of interesting when you take a look at God's plan for man on this planet, and God's always done things in a very organized way, you find that it's interesting that the way that our society has come and the years that we're in, that we're setting ourselves up for a very important thing, a very important event, and it's the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus said in John chapter 14, he says, "You believe in God, believe also in me. And in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not true, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you," Jesus said, "I will come again and will receive you into myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Now, if that's the only verse in the Bible, that's enough to tell me Jesus is coming back. Amen. And he's coming back for his own. And that's exciting to me. I look forward to the second coming of our Lord. Now, there's no way we can go in this thing in great detail like we need to, but I do find it interesting that while the Bible speaks about the last days, it's interesting how psychics and many others who don't believe in the Bible speak about an event that brings us to the end of the world. I don't know how many of you saw the PBS special that talked about the man who could see into the future. Notre Dame is probably one of the most widely read, especially in these last 10, 12 years. A man who lived a few hundred years ago who predicted the death of John F. Kennedy, who said that there would be three major antichrists, and said that the second one would be a man whose name was spelled H-I-S-T-E-R. And of course, he missed it just a little bit by his spelling. It's interesting that Notre Dame places the year 1990 in a very important thing. And I'm going to show you something. This is an album, incidentally, I just picked up at a brand new album just released within the last month. I picked up at a record store in Dayton. And if you notice here, Notre Dame, you see the occult, some of the occult symbolization. And the reason why there's rays coming out of his eyes, that is known as astral projection. It's having out-of-body experiences. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later on. Earlier this year, around March of this year, I was out in the West Coast, and I was at a small town in Northern California, and I went to the local record store. And as I was flipping through the records, I noticed this album by Billy Thorpe. Now, Billy Thorpe was very successful back in the 70s, and there's not been a whole lot done with him since then. But I noticed the album, it was called Children of the Sun Revisited. And that particular album was a very successful album for him. And I flipped it over on the back, and I noticed it says, "Australian star Billy Thorpe's American recording career was launched in 1979 with the release of Children of the Sun, a conceptual album." Now listen to this, right on the back of this album. "A conceptual album that chronicled the visit of extraterrestrials from an advanced benevolent race who rescued and transported the survivors of Earth's Holocaust in 1991 as predicted by Notre Dame to a new planet and a new life." He goes on to say, "The album sold 500,000 copies worldwide before Capricorn Record, the original distributing label, went bankrupt." Incidentally, Capricorn Record is a record company that was named after a zodiac sign, an astrological sign. Now, when you begin to do a little bit of study in a lot of the rock and roll, you'll find some interesting connections into occult activity. And for those of you that don't know, all you'd have to do is read Deuteronomy chapter 18, and you'll find that God forbids the practice of the horoscope, of the zodiac. It's considered a forbidden practice. It's one of the 9 forbidden practices in Deuteronomy chapter 19, because it is an advancement of knowledge through demon power. Now, from what we know from Notre Dame and some of these other psychics, they're claiming that the end of the world is getting ready to take place. None of these men are in agreement and women are in agreement. But they're all believing that something's going to take place. Now, according to the scripture, there's a lot about it. The Bible talks about an end time concept. And today we've heard it so much, many of you no doubt studied it, called the New Age movement. Now, in reality, the New Age movement is nothing really new. It's still the same old occult, given a new flavor to it, a new scenery to it. In the New Age movement, all kinds of activity, from astral projection to psychic power, witchcraft, all the way to heavy-duty occultism, is being glorified. But it's given a new image to it. For example, you go to a local New Age bookstore. I know Kansas City's got three of them. And you'll find a very interesting thing. Just about all these bookstores carry the same kind of stuff, mixed in with satanic Bibles and books on witchcraft. And here's, for example, one on your astral body, psychic powers, exploring inner space, yoga, the tarot cards, psychic awareness, inner journeys, visualization and growth therapy, the Egyptian Book of the Dead, mixed in with obvious books dealing with occult practices, is books like this that's called The Aquarian Gospel of Jesus the Christ. Now, that's very interesting, because these chapters in the book supposedly give the so-called lost books of the Bible that teach things about Jesus that are supposedly the real truths about who he really was. For example, the book here called The Jesus Mystery of Lost Years and Unknown Travels. This book, which shows Jesus sitting on the front cover, he is in meditation and yoga position. He is in a meditation position that's very common in the transcendental meditation movement, with an aura or a force field developing around his head. Now, incidentally, Jesus did not walk around with a little white ring around his head. Okay? That is a psychic concept. Auras and force fields, and in this case, it's a little yellow and purple, supposedly reveals that Jesus was a very good teacher. Now, when you really get into this book, you find out that according to this book, that Jesus was not virgin born, but that he was an actual product of a normal sexual relationship. And at the age of 12, Jesus became very interested in religious things and was brought to Jerusalem, and it was there that he really was confronted with what he wanted to be like. Well, his mother and father made him come back to Nazareth, and they tried to get him married off when he was 13. But he ran away from home, joined a caravan that went to the Middle East, the Far East, and there he sat under the teachings of masters and gurus of the Far East and learned the power of mantras and yantras and became an advanced psychic. And at the age of 30, Jesus returns at just the right time when John the Baptist baptizes Jesus, and suddenly Jesus becomes the Christ. All of a sudden, Christ consciousness falls upon him, and Jesus performs mighty miracles. He's able to do things not because he's the Son of God, but because he's psychic. He can walk on water. He's using levitation. He uses mental telepathy and makes people think that when they're drinking water, they're drinking wine. And this is how this book goes on. Of course, by the time they get to the end of to where the cross is, they say that Jesus did not die on the cross, but actually that he fainted under intense pain. He went into a semi-coma. They took him off the cross, laid him in the tomb. He laid there, and 3 days later, he was able to revive enough that he was able to get up, and he walked out. He got married to Mary Magdalene, had 7 kids, and moved back to India. Okay? Now, of course, this book was written years ago before the movie, you know, we're all hearing about right now. Folks, believe me, these movies and these books, this is nothing new. This is an age-old thing. And it's kind of amazing to me that these people don't understand what the scripture has to say about that. It's very plain. But now you're either going to laugh, as some of you did, or you're going to believe that. Now, there are some that choose to believe that. And to be honest with you, there are more that believe that about Jesus than believe that, as the scripture teaches, that Jesus is God in the flesh and that he is the only way for salvation. And that's what we're going to try to show you tonight. In the Bible, there are about four or five times the word Antichrist appears. It's only found in 1st and 2nd John, the little epistles right before Revelation. Here's one of them. For many deceivers are entered into the world, who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an Antichrist. Now, I want you to listen, because we're going to try to cover a whole lot of things that usually should take two or three nights, and we're going to try to squeeze in as much as we can tonight. I want you to notice what John said would be the major product or teaching of the Antichrist. It is the teaching that Jesus Christ is not in the flesh. Now, what does that mean? Well, for those of you that don't know, remember a moment ago when I was reading from Matthew, I told you, remember those points when they say, I am Christ, and they'll rise false Christ. Christ is not Jesus' last name. I mean, Jesus didn't go up and say, hi, my name is Jesus Christ, what's yours? Christ is a title. Christ means the anointed one, the Messiah. All right, now, there's a teaching that you are going to find that maybe some of you may find shocking. Witches believe that Jesus was the Christ. Buddhists, New Agers believe that Jesus was the Christ. But that he was one of many Christs. Not that he is Jesus Christ, but that he is a man who became Christ after this consciousness fell upon him. In other words, he was just a normal man who became divinely inspired. Now, that teaching, according to the scripture, is the real teaching of Antichrist. Now, I want to show you something. I know a lot of this stuff is, some of you are, I'm losing you, but just stick with me. If you'll start reading in Revelation, you'll notice time after time, over and over again, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3 of Revelation, the church is referred to over and over again. Suddenly in chapter 4, verse 1, John says, I heard a trumpet that says, come up hither. Now, the scripture talks about a trump of God that will sound, and the dead in Christ are going to rise, then we which are alive remain will be called together to be with the Lord. Now, that's what we commonly refer to as the rapture. Now, after that point, you'll never find the church ever referred to again in Revelation. It's never referred to. But you know what happens? From that point on, John sees, from a standpoint looking downward on the earth, some strange events. And in chapter 6, we find John asking, or being asked by an angel, who is worthy to open up this book, this scroll, and read what's getting ready to take place on the planet? Suddenly, Jesus comes on the scene, the Lamb of the Lion of the tribe of Judah, Jesus, the Lamb of God. He breaks those seven seals. You have to read and find out what I'm talking about. And the first four seals that are broken reveal four horsemen, which are symbolic of four major things that's going to transpire immediately after this catching up of the church. The first thing that comes on the scene is a man who is a rider on the white horse. Now, when you think white horse, you think of a good guy. You think of the Lone Ranger or the good guy, always riding on the white horse. And when the Bible describes this man, it says that he has a crown on his head and he's got a bow in his hand. But the Bible says that he's not using any arrows. He is a man who, as a king, is going to come to conquer, but he's doing it in the name of anti-war. He's a man of peace. Now, if you'll study this out, you'll find out that this is a man of sin, the scripture refers to him, the wicked one, the son of perdition, the beast of Revelation. He's the Antichrist. He's an embodiment of a man who declares that he can rule the world. He's Notre Dame's third beast, Antichrist. But oddly enough, after this man comes on the scene and signs a peace treaty with Israel, guaranteeing them a 7-year peace plan, the next thing that transpires, the Bible says, is a rider on a red horse. Now, this rider has a huge sword, the scripture says. And he goes out to make warfare, and all over this world it will come into a war. It's interesting that Paul said in Thessalonians, when they cry, peace, peace, peace and safety, sudden destruction will come upon them. Well, according to the scripture, there will be another major world war, what we would probably call World War III. Now, according to the scripture, this will be a major war that thousands and millions of people will die in. Now, I don't have the time to go into all the detail to tell you why, but I believe that America, according to this prophecy, will see its destruction at that time. Now, I don't have time to get into all to it, but if you don't agree with that, that's fine. But I think it's very interesting to me that the Bible refers to little nation of Israel, refers to Greece, refers to Iran, Iraq, Russia, China, Japan, Germany, all these other ones. But America is not found in Bible prophecies in the very end. And it could very possibly be because America does no longer exist. Right after that, the Bible says that a major world famine will strike the earth after this major world war, very possibly because of the, if it's a nuclear war, which very possibly can be, the aftermath of that can produce famine. And the scripture says that this horse, this rider on the black horse comes and he's got a scale in his hand, a weight scale. And he hollers out an equation. And it basically, in modern day terminology, he hollers these words. $1,000 for a loaf of bread. In other words, that's how scarce food will be. It will take $1,000, which in many cases is what it takes an average wage earner to bring home in a month's time to buy a loaf of bread. That's how scarce. Famine will strike this world all over. And then the scripture says, following that, is a rider on a pale horse, and behind him is hell. Death and hell. And according to the scripture, what's getting ready to transpire after that will cause nearly 3 billion people on this planet to die within a 7-year span. That's why Jesus said, great tribulation as the world's never seen. Now, before we can ever examine all that, and there's no way we could cover it tonight, I want to talk about tonight in the realm of rock music and how it ties in to this man right here. A rider on the white horse. A man who claims world peace. A man who comes, who is, interesting enough, anti-war. He is pro-peace. This man, the scripture says, will deceive many. Now, I've already read to you much, but I want to show you something. Brenda Carlisle had an album, a hit off this album that was one of the big hits earlier this year. Actually, it's the title of the album itself, Heaven on Earth. And in the song, she talks about heaven being found on this earth. Utopia on this planet. And if you're really catching what's going on, there's two major circles of teachings about this New Age movement. The New Age promises that the world is coming into a harmonic age, an age of peace. Here is one of their major statements of faith. Now, if you've not heard of the New Age movement, listen closely. And those of you in the back, I don't know if you can see this, but I'll read this to you. And listen closely. Everybody, please listen. I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'm just going to show you a few points. In whatever religion you have been taught, however you have been brought up, and however you have understood your teachers, on these levels you will understand and grasp this message. It is not enough that this message be believed. It is a message to be lived. Now, keep in mind, I'm reading more or less the manifesto to the New Age. The essence of universal religion is peace and truth with love for and kindness to all the creatures of the earth. Now, this has a familiar ring to it because the Bible says that the major concept of the Antichrist teaching will be universal everything. One world government, one world religion, one world power, global concept, and that he will preach peace and safety to the world. Now, I'm going to have to skip a bunch because there's no way we can read all this, but I want you to notice right here, it says, a revelation will occur to you, a revelation higher than your exalted dreams. The New Age is coming, and in it there will be a realization of the oneness of all. Now remember that. That's a very Extremely important thing. Now, I know for some of you this is starting off kind of slow, but you stick with me, it'll get better. The new age is coming, and there is a realization of the oneness of all. Now that sounds sweet and cuddly, but listen on. Differences between the various religions will disappear. The good, which is in each of them, will be fused and will become the common goal of all mankind. In other words, the basic underlining teaching is the brotherhood of man and the fatherhood of God. In other words, everything is going to come into perfect harmony, and everybody's going to love one another, and all religions are going to unite, and we're just going to love everybody. Now that sounds good. But I want you to understand tonight, as I mentioned last night, sharing that what we were going to do with tonight, that last night's message was obvious. When I showed you those slides, there was no question. But tonight, I'm going to show you part of the story. And to be honest with you, this is where Satan's masterpiece is at. Understand, my friend, that religion is merely a man's attempt to find God. And Satan is the author of religion. And I'm going to say something that's going to sound kind of hard, but you listen, because there's going to be some other things that may shock you. Religion will send you straight to hell. Now, did I hear you right, John? Yes. Religion will send you to hell. Christianity is not a religion. I'll prove this to you tonight. There is a vast difference. Now, with all that in mind, you say, well, John, what in the world has this got to do with rock music? Well, let me show you something. Earth, Wind, and Fire has released a new album this year. It's been a semi-successful album for them. But Earth, Wind, and Fire, whose leader, incidentally, is Maurice White. Maurice White believes he's been reincarnated 3 previous times. He believes he's in his 3rd reincarnation, hence he uses 3 of the 5 elements of witchcraft. Now, witchcraft uses a symbol called a pentagram. Penta meaning 5 points. There's 5 major points to witchcraft: earth, wind, fire, water, spirit. Now, you can study this in any library you go to. Well, oddly enough, Maurice White called his group Earth, Wind, and Fire to represent those 3 incarnations he's been through. He believes strongly in pyramidology and Egyptology. He's heavily into the concept of New Age teaching. Now I want to show you something. This album, which is called All in All, shows the apex of the pyramid, which incidentally is not on the pyramid, which is the only left of the 7 wonders of the world that's still standing. And by the way, let me just say this. Have you ever wondered how in the world did they get those 20-ton stones from rock quarries hundreds of miles away, carved to perfection back 5,000 years ago and brought them? I mean, the cranes and our advanced technology cannot reproduce that. And that the dimensions of that pyramid, when copied on any scale, small scale or large scale, has psychic power to it. Can make strange things happen. Can make plants grow. Can sharpen dull razor blades overnight. I mean, you're talking about some pretty weird stuff. But oddly enough, if you'll notice, when you open up this album, there is a pyramid in the back, but now the apex of the pyramid has an eye in it. And I don't think anybody hasn't seen this before here. If you've noticed, on the back of your dollar bill on the left-hand side is a pyramid with an eye on the top of it. Now, has that ever entered in your mind? What in the world is a pyramid doing on the back of the dollar bill? And there's no such thing as a pyramid in the United States. That's not a symbol of the United States. And why is it called the Great Seal and it has Latin words, Honorat Corpus Novus Ordo Seclorum, written around it? Now, how many people speak Latin here tonight? One person. Do you know what it says? Anuit corpus Novus Ordo Seclorum. Announcing the birth of a new world order. That symbol, incidentally, if you'll study it out, I have time. It's on our, we got a tape series back in the back called Rock Music and Bible Prophecy. Tells the details about it. It appeared on the dollar bill after the Depression. And it's kind of interesting about that, and I don't even know why I'm getting on that. I'm really getting myself backtracked on that. But that eye is overlooking these 12 pillars. Now, each one of those pillars has a different major symbol. You've got the sign of the Roman sign of peace, the Roman god of peace, Jupiter. Next to that is the common sign of medicine that most of you have seen before. Next to that is Buddha in the lotus plant, representing Buddhism. The next one is a poltergeist, a spirit coming out of a vase. Poltergeist, spiritism, which incidentally is a major belief, religious system. Reincarnation, which is the backbone of Egyptology. That's an Ankh cross, an Egyptian cross, goes back about 5,000 years ago. The hexagram, which is an occult symbol. It's a black magic symbol. Hexagrams, where they use it to place a hex on something. The menorah, which is the true Jewish symbol. The seven golden candlestick. Next to that is the eye of wisdom, the eye of Ra, the sun god. Next to that is Shakespeare, representing wisdom. Next to that, Christian cross, representing Christianity, Hinduism, and then, of course, musical instruments representing music. And this is all in all. Now, what does that mean, John? Well, if you study this out, one of the songs on the album called Jupiter talked that a man of peace is getting ready to bring this world under unity, under the power of that eye in the pyramid, and going to bring about a new world order, an order of universal global peace. Now, I'm saying all those things to say this. When I say Shirley MacLaine, many of you obviously know Shirley MacLaine is probably one of the biggest evangelists from the New Ager standpoint. This was on the cover of Time magazine back in December. It says Om, which incidentally is a mantra. It's a Hindu demon god, Om. It's a mantra you say over and over again. The New Age, starring Shirley MacLaine, faith healers, channelers, space travelers, and crystals galore. Well, folks, this is an organized religious movement. The New Age declares that something transpired last year that marks a prophetic statement that goes back to the Aztec religion, the Mayan Indians, that declares the world has come into a new age. And incidentally, this new age goes right hand in hand with the biblical reference to a man of peace, because this new age, they say, is an age of universal peace. It's called the Age of Aquarius. This is the latest from a band called Yes. They were very successful back in the 70s. On this particular album has been two top 10 hits in the last few months. I noticed when I was looking at the record, the very last song on the album is called Holy Lamb, and then in parentheses it says Song for Harmonic Convergence. I don't know how many of you remember, a year ago and a week was a nationwide and worldwide phenomenon. It was a phenomenon that people from all over the planet gathered for 2 days, August 14th and 15th, to meditate to help align this planet with what was called the Age of Aquarius. How many remember the harmonic convergence that was advertised and talked about? The harmonic convergence made a statement that said we are uniting and harmonizing the world for a time of universal peace. Now, how many of you can remember a song back in 1970, I guess this will show the age for some of you, a song that was called The Age of Aquarius. How many remember that particular song? Okay, that's a great deal of you. This is the album that appeared on, a group called The Fifth Dimension, which incidentally, just the name itself, a dimension of consciousness, is where they even got their name. This particular song appeared on this album, which on the front cover you see the zodiac symbols all the way around with certain dates. When you open up the album itself, you notice all the band members, all the group there, and each one of them have their date, their name, their date, and the zodiac sign. For example, here's Marilyn McCoo, who is now with Solid Gold, has her birth date and her astrological zodiac sign. I want you to listen very carefully to the song. Now, for some of you that's not heard it, this is going to sound kind of silly, but This is what rock and roll was all about during the 60s and 70s. The moon is in the seventh house, and Jupiter aligns with Mars. Peace will guide our planet.
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius.
Keep in mind, that was a hit 18 years ago. Now, if you asked a normal person back then what they're singing about, most of them had no idea. It just had a attractive sound to it. People going around, this is the dawning age of Aquarius. Had no idea what they meant when Jupiter's in the seventh house, or when the moon is in the seventh house and Jupiter's aligned with Mars. Peace will guide our planets and love will steer the stars. What in the world did that mean? Well, that was dealing with an alignment. A zodiac alignment, which the stars and the planets were declaring the world was coming into a new age. Now keep in mind, this was not only psychics predicting this, but major religious cults and even Aztec gods, and I mean religion, the Mayan Indians, all predicted that on those two dates, that alignment of planets, which incidentally did take place, was going to usher in a new age. Now, many people say, how do you explain the star in Bethlehem? Couldn't it be an alignment of planets that appeared to be a star? So therefore, many have taught that this new alignment of these planets ushered in, as it did in Jesus' days, the age of Pisces, they said. And of course, Pisces was represented by fish. And incidentally, if you guys know your local radio station here, Christian radio station, the symbol that Christians have used for almost 2,000 years has been the symbol of the fish. And they say the Piscean Age was the age of the Christians, but now we've come into the age of Aquarius, which is a symbol of peace, which is incidentally an upside down broken cross, which is anti-Christ. See? Now, with all this in mind, the alignment of the planets, an age to come to bring peace. Let me bring this a little closer to home. Here's a guy that has finally discovered his crotch area. You've seen the video too, obviously. That's a pretty good name for the album, Bad. A lot of people in Kansas City area thought themselves to be real privileged because Michael Jackson started the tour in Kansas City. What a great privilege, huh? Well, Michael Jackson, for those of you that don't know, was the man who has sold more albums, a singular album, than any other man in history. 38 million copies of the Thriller album. This album has broken another record. Its album, according to Billboard charts, has had more top one hits than any other previous album there's ever been. Now, Michael Jackson, while some will try to laugh and snigger, is a very prominent, popular artist. A song that's being played right now at the tops of the charts is a song that's the first song on side two. It's called Another Part of Me. Now, if you ask the kid who just went, woo, what that song's talking about, they probably couldn't tell you. But listen to what it says. We're taking over. We have the truth. This is the mission to see it through. Now, what's he taking over and what kind of truth is he sharing? Well, listen. Don't point your finger. Not dangerous. This is our planet. You're one of us. All right, what are you trying to say? We're sending out a major love. And this is our message to you. And here it is in plain black and white. The planets are lining up. We're bringing brighter days. They're all in line waiting for you. Can't you see? You're just another part of me. Now you say, well, John, I don't understand. What's so bad about that? Well, isn't it interesting that the manifesto for the New Agers said that the teaching would be the oneness of all? Now Michael Jackson, a star, has come up who declares that there's a message of taking over the world, and it holds the truth, and that this message based on love says, because the planets are lining up, it's bringing us brighter days, bringing us into a perfect unity, because you're just another part of me. To be honest with you folks, that is just age-old pantheism. The oneness of all. You and I are all part of the universal mind of God. You're just another part of me. I am God, you are God, the rock is God, the sky is God, the tree is God. We are all God. We are parts of God. We are the universal mind of God. That is the backbone of this teaching. Now, when Michael Jackson made it on the front page of People magazine a few months ago, I thought it was interesting when it said, from backstage on his frenzied world tour comes a strange pleading message from Michael. Now listen to what it says here. I was sent forth for the world, for the children. But have mercy, for I've been bleeding a long time now. Now before I get into this, let me just say that Michael had a change in his life in the last time from his Thriller album. He who once was devoted to a cult religion called Jehovah's Witnesses, who teach that Jesus was merely an angel who became a man, who did not die on a cross, who did not resurrect physically, and if you're wrong, if they're wrong, no worry, because there ain't no hell anyway. See. Well, he's left that. But Michael Jackson has went a stage up. I don't know how many of you have ever wondered, what is this reason for all the facial changes? Why is it that he wants to not look black anymore? And why is it that Michael Jackson is so consumed with buying the bones of the Elephant Man? What has gone through this guy's mind to do some of the things and to be so much into what he is? For example, though, I want you to listen to what it says. This is right during his Japan tour. In the midst of a world tour, the astonishing star breaks his 4-year silence to issue a cry of pain from Japan. And incidentally, notice what the article's called. Michael's First Epistle. Here is what Michael Jackson handwrote to be published. I'm going to read it to you. And I'll highlight on in a minute. Like the old Indian proverb says, do not judge a star until you've walked, a slave until you've walked 2 moons in his moccasins. Most people don't know me. That is why they write such things in which most is not true. I cry very, very often because it hurts, and I worry about the children. Now listen carefully how he says this. All my children all over the world, I live for them. If a man could say nothing against a character but what he could prove, history could not be written. Animals strike not with malice, but because they want to live. It is the same with those who criticize. They desire our blood. All capital letters, incidentally. His blood now deserves a capital B. Not our pain, but still I must achieve. I must seek truth in all things. I must endure for the power. Now listen, I must endure for the power. I was sent forth for the world, for the children. But have mercy, for I have been bleeding, capital B, a long time now. Now, what in the world is he saying? What does he mean by he was sent into the world for the children? And that his blood is a very important thing, and they're wanting his blood, but he's crying for the children, all the children. Now, folks, what I'm getting ready to say is almost, well, some of you just may not believe this, but it's going to be in plain black and white. You'll see in a minute. It's very interesting that Michael Jackson believes, a segment, incidentally, of Jehovah's Witnesses taught this before all the controversy came out, that Michael Jackson was the reincarnation of Jesus. Seriously. And because his name was Michael, they placed him into a prophetic statement made by Daniel that referred to the last days, Daniel chapter 12 and verse 1. This is in your Bible, ladies and gentlemen. At that time shall Michael, this was written 500 years before Jesus. At that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as never since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. And I don't know how many of you saw the documentary on Michael Jackson a couple weeks ago. Michael Jackson is a world success, not just America, but in almost every part of the globe, kids all over the place. And I saw scenes from it, and here's these girls screaming and crying, and people, I mean, just about running over each other just to get a glimpse of Michael. And all the while this is going on, Michael Jackson has now come to the place that he's bought a machine that is a hyperbaric chamber that puts him into a perfect pure mixture of oxygen so that he will live until they discover the answer to death. Matter of fact, it's written in his contract that if he dies, they have to freeze his body because he believes that they're going to raise him back to life. Now, Michael Jackson was back at the top of the charts just a few weeks ago with another hit. The song has Christians declaring he's a great man. Many believe that Michael Jackson is a powerful man of a message. And that maybe, just maybe, to those who would believe he is this chosen Christ, which is ridiculous, maybe his answer is through music. And so what does he sing? Well, it's a song that many preachers I've heard say, comments, a real good scriptural song, they say.
I'm standing with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways. And no message gonna mend any clever. If you wanna make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and then make a change.
Now say, now John, you're not going to say that there's anything possibly that could be wrong with that song, is there? Well, let's take a look at it. I'm starting with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways, and there no message could have been any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and then make a change. Now folks, listen, that sounds really true, don't it? That sounds right on. But the Bible says, be not deceived, for Satan himself is able to transform himself into an angel of light. And no marvel that his ministers, as ministers of righteousness. You say, well, John, what do you see wrong with that song? The core backbone of this guy who's already declared to be a major part of the New Age concept declares that the answer to world peace is looking to ourselves and bettering ourselves. You say, well, what's wrong with that? Let me show you what's wrong with that. James chapter 1. But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Notice what it says before I go to the next verse. Deceiving your own selves. Do you know Jesus warned that the last days would be marked by people that would be very deceptive? Their teachings would be deceptive, and they would say, I am of Christ. I follow him. But look what it says. For if you be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man beholding his natural face in a mirror.
I'm standing with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways. And no
better place. Take a look at yourself, then make a change.
You say, well, John, I don't see what's so bad about that. We'll go on to the next verse. For he that beholdeth himself and goeth his way and immediately forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law, now listen to this, the perfect law of liberty and continueth in it, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. What in the world is that saying? That says this, listen, you can look at the man in the mirror all you want to, friend, but that's not going to change you, or it's not going to change the world. The Bible says there's another thing you're to look to. It's not looking at yourself to try to make yourself better. It's to look to Jesus. Not look at the man in the mirror, but to look at the man in the middle. I'm looking at the man in the middle. I'm asking him to change my ways. There's no message could be any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, if you want to make the world a better place, take a look at Jesus and then he'll make the change. My friend, listen, there's some of you sitting here tonight. You honestly believe that by trying to change your life, trying to turn over a new leaf and trying to be good and do good things and treat people good, that that's going to make you right with God. Listen, my friend, your good deeds, according to the scripture, your good deeds are as filthy rags. If you could be good enough, there would be no purpose for Jesus to come and die on Calvary. Now, do you understand? Listen, but while we're still freshly on our mind, understand, my friend, that in and of itself is an anti-Christ teaching. It says, I can do it myself. I don't need Jesus for salvation. Now, by the way, Michael Jackson, let me see what my problem is here. Somebody loan me a penny here or something, or a quarter or something. Seems like every time I get on this message, my machines mess up here. Kind of a little interesting thing, wouldn't you say? I'm going to show you something that's interesting. Michael Jackson is one of many, thank you, brother, one of many people that have had extreme success in convincing people that goodness and good deeds is the answer to our world's problems. Now, Michael Jackson has a brand new book that has already been a number one bestseller on the New York list here. Oh, by the way, I want to show you this. Michael Jackson's song, Man in the Mirror, says Michael Jackson, solo, background vocals. And listen to the people they list. Winans, Andre Crouch. Let's get down here. The Winans, Gavin, Marvin, Michael, and Ronald Winans, Andre Crouch, and the Andre Crouch Choir, Sandra Crouch. You know all those background vocals, those beautiful background vocals? You know who those are? Those are some contemporary Christian artists. Now, what in the world's going on when some of our people are backing up people that they'd never back us up? Hello? I just thought I'd throw that in. Moonwalk is the title of Michael Jackson's book. Now, we're not going to go into all the great details, but I do want to show you an interesting quote from Michael Jackson concerning his music and how he gets his messages. Now, keep in mind, here's a man who has declared himself to be sent to the world to save the children. His message has basically been, do good, be good, and we can change the world. But how does he write his music, the book says. I wake up from dreams and go, wow, put this down on paper. The whole thing is strange. You hear the words, everything is right there in front of your face, and you say to yourself, I'm sorry, I just didn't write this. It's there already. Listen to this. I feel that somewhere, someplace, it's all been done and I'm the courier bringing it into the world. I'm the messenger that's bringing this message to the world. And folks, this message is being heard loud and clear. Now, this is not the only thing that Michael Jackson's ever done that's had world success. Almost everything seemingly his hands touches seems to be hot nowadays. And here was one.
We are the world. We are the children.
Now, wait a minute, John. You're not going to tell me that there's anything wrong with We Are the World. Well, before I get into it, I want you to listen to Jane Fonda, who everybody knows is a real friend of America. hear what she has to say about We Are the World.
The recording of We Are the World was quite an event. Not merely a glorious star-studded evening, but possibly one of the most idealistic occasions in pop music history. In that way, it was also a measurement of just how much pop music has grown in recent years, and how many of its best artists feel responsible to the world around them. But in many ways, what happened that night was just a start. In the weeks following the We Are the World sessions, several other groups of artists, including Canadian, Latin American, gospel, and African pop stars, recorded similar benefit singles for the relief of hunger in Africa and other parts of the world. Perhaps the most moving response to USA for Africa took place on the morning of April 5th,
Good Friday,
when over 8,000 radio stations around the globe played We Are the World at the same time. It was an utterly unprecedented event that reached and affected millions
Listen
of people.
Listen to what she said, that the world is a neighborhood of concern. It's within a global concept. Now, folks, listen, this is going to get kind of interesting, so I want you to invite attention. Here is a song that is she was introducing on the video for We Are the World, a song that reached all around the world to people of almost every race and belief. The message that was coming out of the song was a message that said something very, very strongly. But you know the interesting thing about it? Even in Christian circles, many declared that this is truly God's message to the world. And because it was done to help eliminate starving Ethiopian problems, people said, obviously, this is good. So what happened? We swallowed this thing, hook, line, and sinker. Now, keep in mind the concept. Let's go into the opening lines of the song here.
There comes a time when we heed a certain call. When the world must come together as one.
Well, let me just stop there for just a moment. There comes a time when we heed a certain call, when the world, now listen, when the world must come together as one. The closing line of the song, let us realize that a change can only come when we stand together as one. The opening line and the closing line, without any doubt, make it a statement of fact that the world must become one. John, what's wrong with that? You'll see later. But understand that this song is declaring that the answer can only happen as we become a unity. Now, again, remember back earlier from the New Age message that universalism had to be it. The oneness of all had to be the major concept. Now, let's go on into the song.
There are people dying. Oh, when it's time to lend a hand to life, the greatest gift of all. We can't go on pretending day by day that the moon.
Now listen closely
somewhere
to what's getting ready to be said.
Change. We all are part of God's great big family. And the truth, you know love is all we need.
It says something extremely important. We are all a part of God's great big family, and the truth, you know, love is all we need. That is the biggest lie that hell has ever puked up. Now, I know what some of you think. You're crazy. But no, you wait a minute. If that statement is true, if we are all a part of God's great big family, then that means that we're all in the family of God. Therefore, we don't need to be born again. Let me tell you, according to Scripture, you are not a part of the family of God until you've been adopted into the family of God through the blood of Jesus Christ, His one and only Son. Michael Jackson bought the copyrights to what? Do any of you know? To all the Beatles stuff. Thank you. It was in the early 70s that a song was played on the same way that We Are the World was played. And it was played over 500 radio stations around the country. Does anybody remember the title of that song? Imagine's one of them, but there was another one. All We Need Is Love. Remember that? Love is all we need. Kind of has a familiar ring to it. Michael Jackson wrote that line. Love is all we need. Oh, is that right? So what we're doing now, we're telling people that you are a part of God's great family simply because you're a human being. Therefore, we just need to love one another. Well, now, before I go any further, let me just tell you, my friend, that either that is true or Jesus is true, because both of them don't agree. And Jesus even told the most religious people of his days, the Pharisees and Sadducees, you are of your father, the devil. Now, if we're all part of God's great big family and they were a part of the family, then friend, that puts you and I as Satan is our father. Hello? And in reality, friend, you and I are born not into the family of God. We're born again into the family of God. Now, you are no doubt a part of God's creation, but that does not automatically make you a Christian. The other day, I was talking to a lady. I was waiting for my wife. She was in a store. And sometimes that can take pretty long. And I was sitting out in front of this mall, and I sit next to this elderly lady. And I said, ma'am, I just want to share Christ with her. I said, ma'am, are you a Christian? She looked at me and she says, well, yes, I'm a Christian. I was born in the United States. Listen, friend, you can go down to McDonald's, but that will not make you a quarter pounder. Amen. Just because you're born in the United States and just because you go to church does not make you a Christian either. The Bible says you've got to be born again. But the lady who sang that line, her name is Tina Turner. Now, Tina Turner has a book out about her life called I, Tina. And interesting enough, when you study out Tina, you find that that's what she believes. She believes that we're all part of God's great big family. Obviously, her philosophies come through loud and clear. In the book, you can see the book, you can go down in paper or any bookstore and pick it up. This is one of her favorite pieces of furniture in her house, she declared. Which you see the sun disk in the middle, and all the way around it are the zodiac symbols, the horoscope. Now, if you study and read about it, you'll find her and I got messed up in some pretty weird religious teachings. And now Tina is a devotee to the Buddhist religion. She says that she looks forward to the day of retiring from rock and roll so that she can go full time to teach Buddhism. Life magazine did a big article on her about a year and a half ago. In this article was a full page picture, as you see it here right now. At the bottom, below her picture is this caption. I'll give you a close-up shot. Says Tina, who chants regularly at her own Buddhist altar, quote, in this faith, you decide what is right and wrong. Well, then I can probably explain to you why she teaches that we're all part of God's great big family. Because according to Buddha, he was one of the ways to heaven. Now, Buddha said that he pointed to the way. But he also taught that Krishna and Muhammad and Vishnu and the other ones also pointed the way. But isn't it interesting? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. Jesus said he was the only way. Jesus didn't say I'm one of the ways, and Buddha's one of the ways, and Krishna's one of the ways, Muhammad's one of the ways, Vishnu's one of the ways, Jim Jones is one of the ways, Michael Jackson's one of the ways. No, Jesus said I'm it. And nobody else ever said that. Isn't it interesting? All religious groups talk about Jesus. They can't deny the man existed. And they'll all put it this way. Well, he was a very good prophet. Or they'll say he was a very good teacher. Well, if he's a good teacher, why don't they believe his teaching? Amen. Hello. Amen. And Jesus never ever come close to saying that he was just one of the ways. Jesus declared, if you're going to get to God, you've got to go through me. Therefore, calling Buddha a liar. Amen. Well, now that doesn't sound like too much love to me now. Well, really? Do you mean to tell me that telling you the truth, sometimes it'll hurt you, that that's not being loving? If love is all we need, then friend, there's a lot of misguided people in the world who have a lot of love. We can't justify everything because of love. Another person who sang in that album was Stevie Wonder. Remember I showed you earlier on Notre Dame, those rays coming out of his eyes. Incidentally, this album's called Inner Visions. And for those of you that don't remember, Stevie Wonder's blind. He can't see, but he has inner visions. And you can see him as he's got a ray that's coming between the forehead and his eyes there. And then over to the sides, the pyramids, which is a major part of Stevie Wonder's teaching. Stevie Wonder's heavily involved into that same meditation kind of religion. I want you to notice the second song on side two in this album is called Jesus, Children of America. Listen.
Hello, Jesus, children. Jesus loves you, Jesus, children. Hello, children, Jesus loves you, America.
Hello, children, Jesus loves you, children of America. Now, you say, wow, he must be a Christian. Well, listen on into his song. Now, let's get back to what we're talking about. We're talking about a song that says we are the world. Before I do that, though, I want to read to you a very important scripture, because there are still some of you sitting here and saying, now, wait a minute, am I understanding you to say that that song is not of God? Well, yes, and I'm going to prove it to you right here. Anytime the devil writes something, he always messes it up, okay? The Bible says he's a liar and he's the father of all lies. So that means every time he says something, he ends up lying. All right, let me read to you. Matthew chapter 4. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward a-hungered. By the way, you know what I saw today? It just almost made me sick. This guy who's been fasting because of something about him spraying something on, you know, stuff on grapes. He takes communion. And Jesse Jackson says, I'll fast 3 days. And you know what they do? They give him a cross. He says he's going to take the cross. And he wraps it around his neck and says he's going to fast for these grapes. Carrying a cross? I mean, brother, listen, isn't it interesting today that there is such a religious spirit in this country? That if anybody, of all things, instead of fasting for those poor little grapes, they ought to be fasting, or for the people who got affected, they ought to be fasting for the bunch of drunks that get alcoholics because of them grapes. See? But anyway, here this guy's going around going to wear a cross for 3 days now. He's going to be a real good person. Brother, listen, you can wear a cross. That don't mean anything. And as I said it yesterday, Jesus doesn't ask you to wear a cross. He says, bear a cross. See? But anyway, it says, and when the tempter came to him, he said, if you be the Son of God. Now see, that's the issue that Satan doesn't like. Buddha, Krishna, Muhammad, all the rest of them were good men who did good deeds, and they died and their bodies rotted. Jesus is not in his grave because he wasn't a mere man. He was God's son, the scripture says. The only begotten son of God. Well, that was the issue Satan was trying to deal with. He says, if you are who you say you are, then turn these stones to bread. Now answer the question, did the Lord turn stone to bread? Oh, really? Well, then somebody is messing something up, because the scripture makes it clear that Jesus said to Satan to get away, because man does not live by bread alone. Well, let's listen what happens in the song.
Well, send them your heart so they know that someone cares, and their lives will be stronger and free
as God has shown us.
Here's Willie Nelson. Hello? Now, either Willie was drinking a little bit too much and didn't realize what he's saying. As God has shown us, by turning stone to bread, so we must all lend a helping hand. Well, guess what, brother? The Lord didn't turn stone to bread. He wasn't showing us anything because he didn't do it. And if he would have turned stone to bread, guess who would have been his boss from that day on? Satan. Isn't that something? But we got Christians going around, hey, I think it's a pretty good song. And they think it's a pretty good song because it's got some sweet little lyrics to it. Well, brother, let's just be honest and let's examine it for what it really says. The chorus of the song, the major point, listen closely.
Beyond the children, beyond the ones who make it brighter than day, so let's start giving. There's a choice we're making, we're saving our own lives. It's true, we make a better day, just you and me.
Now let's just analyze that. Many of you sat here, and as I played that, you could sing right along with it because you listened to it so much, and you're back there and you're thinking, oh, this is such a good song, and I'm such a good person, we're all just going to go to heaven because we're so good. Let me show you what it says. We are the world. Now, if you don't know what humanism is, and by the way, this is the epitome of humanism. It's the epitome of making man a god. We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's start giving. There's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives. It's true. We'll make a better day. Just you and me. Now, back up for just a minute here. There's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives. Look what Jesus said. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake in the gospel, the same shall save it. Are you listening to what it said? I mean, let's take a look at it again. There is a choice we're making. Well, Michael Jackson, Lionel Richie, you guys wrote the song. What's the choice you're making? We're saving our own lives. And see, that's come out over and over again in all the lyrics. We don't need Jesus. We're doing it ourselves. Let's look at the man in the mirror. We'll save our own lives. We'll read it again, friend. If you save your life, you're going to lose it. Amen. And then if you lose your life for Jesus, if you give all your rights over to him, then you'll save it, my friend. Amen. See, man, from the very beginning, this is what I meant by the religious deception. Man, from the very beginning, tried to design his own way to cover his sins. When Adam and Eve sinned, what did they do? They ran from God. Instead of running to him, they ran from him. And they designed the first dresses and outfits to cover their nakedness, which was a representation of what happens when you sin. So they tried to cover their nakedness. And you know what? They didn't think about this. But those fig leaves would only last for a few hours and they'd wither away. You know what God did, brother? God came and he shed blood. He shed the blood of an innocent animal to typify what was going to come to pass after that, when he looked at serpent, Satan, and says, that promised one, the seed of the woman, will come and will bruise your head, Satan. And sure enough, brother, The Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world, His blood was shed to cover and to take care of man's sin. Now I want you to listen to this. We are the world, huh? It says we are the world? Well, listen to what John said. They are of the world. Therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are the world. Isn't it interesting? The world accepted it. But listen, it goes on to say, we are of God. He that knoweth God hears us. He that is not of God heareth not of. Hereby know ye the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. See, my friend, listen. There is truth and there is error. Do you know what the New Age movement says? It says there are no absolutes. They say everything is a gray area. You can't say this is for sure. And I was arguing with one of these New Agers, and they say, there's no absolutes. And I said, are you sure? And he says, absolutely. Now, isn't that stupid? But there's two ways. It's either truth or it's error. It's either going to take you to heaven or it's going to take you to hell. And brother, isn't that the issue when it all boils down? Oh, but now, John, we just need to love everybody and just forget all our differences. You're wrong, friend. Amen. Here's what the Bible says. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. And how will you know? Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist. Isn't it interesting that music is laying the foundation on a religious tone that subtly says Jesus is not the answer? You and I are the answer. We are the world, and we're going to make a brighter day. Incidentally, the other guy that wrote that song was Lionel Richie. Everybody thinks Lionel Richie writes great love songs, but isn't it interesting how much his love songs has done his marriage? How many of you caught that in the news last couple days? Hello? Dancing on the Ceiling was his latest hit, our latest album, and the latest hit that came out of that was a song called Sila. Listen to the lyrics. It's time, you know, for everyone to come together. I know it's hard, but this dream must come to light. Because life should be one big celebration. I'm talking to you now. Only we can make things right. Then it goes in the chorus, Sila. And then it goes on to say, all the children, tell me about the children. We've got to help them now to survive. Now listen, one world, one heart is our salvation. Let us keep the dream alive. Well, obviously, Lionel Richie has not read from Acts chapter 4, verse 12, which says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Friend, isn't it interesting that he says our answer to salvation is one world, to bring one world and one heart into motion, for there to be a united world, a one world concept. And that is our salvation. And isn't it interesting that that message is being declared to young people? And young people are swallowing it hook, line, and sinker. And one of the reasons why is because there's that forbidding of the Word of God in our schools, so they can't hear truth, and they're getting fed humanism, situational ethics, all the lies that are coming out, and suddenly rock and roll says, look how good we are. And incidentally, have you ever thought about this for a minute? Whatever happened to those millions of dollars that was raised for that? Well, friend, guess what? All that grain and all those monies didn't do a whole lot of good, because most of it never made it because of communism. Matter of fact, it helped to support armed warfare for communist movements. Incidentally, friend, let me also say something. Next time you see pictures of starving Ethiopians, starving people from Calcutta, India. And by the way, man, the church has been sending missionaries and support to those people for hundreds of years, and they're being made fun of. But you get a bunch of reprobates and perverts and homos and drunks and alcoholics together to sing one song and devote about 3 hours of their time. And they say, well, how great these people are. But by the way, friend, now listen to me. The scripture talks about in the last days doctrines of devils. And one of the prominent doctrines of devils that's coming out of this New Age movement is the doctrine of reincarnation. And in that doctrine is a very important phrase. It's called karma. K-A-R-M-A. Remember little boy George? Karma, 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 reunion. Well, what in the world was he talking about? Karma, chameleon. Well, a chameleon changes all the time. And in karma, which is a Hindu concept, a Hindu philosophy in reincarnation, that when you die, you will come back in your next life according to what you did in your former life. Therefore, man produces his own salvation by bettering himself. So if you want to be better in the next life, go through this life without complaining and being good. Next time, you watch those people and starving Ethiopian other, do you ever notice that flies jump all over them and they don't ever squish them away or try to kill them? You know the reason why? Because they may be killing one of their ancestors. Have you ever noticed you go down Calcutta, India, on both sides of the street are people dying by the thousands? I mean, open sewers running around. And brother, listen to me, people dying every day, skin and bones, and guess what? A fat cow goes walking across the street and decides to stop in the middle of the street and lay down and take a rest. It'll stop traffic for hours. If it urinates, they'll jump and run over everybody to try to catch it and bowls to drink it because they think it's divine. You know the reason why? Because they consider rats and cows to be the two most sacred beings on this planet. You heard the phrase, holy cow? Well, that's where it comes from, seriously. I'm serious. I'm serious, really. And have you ever noticed in Calcutta, they don't have McDonald's hamburgers. And the reason why? Because nobody wants to eat grandpa. Now, we laugh because that's silly to us. But brother, listen, those people believe that so much they are starving to death because of it. That's what the Bible speaks about as doctrines of devils. And the basic doctrine of that teaching says that if you will go through this life without complaining, maybe in your next life you'll come back rich. And the very reason why you're starving this life is probably because in your previous life you didn't feed somebody else. And in that situation, if you're born poor, you die poor. If you're born in a bad situation, you die in a bad... You can't better yourself. And brother, listen. Wherever the gospel of Jesus Christ has been preached and has been rejected, that's the results. It's nothing but heartache, famine, destruction, war, death, all the rest of it. But brother, wherever the gospel of Jesus has come, it's set men free. It's brought them peace and safety and blessing and prosperity and bountifulness. Isn't that interesting? Because brother, under Jesus, you can become better. But under religion, you don't have any choice. Now listen to me. That's why religion and Christianity are different. Religion offers no hope to man. Christianity says, man did something for you, or God did something for you. I'll tell you more about it in a minute. Remember it said that it's the children that's going to help us, and it's saving the children and the rest of that. The other day we're in a meeting. Somebody brought this book up, and we had like a record breaking one night during the crusade, and they brought this in to be destroyed. And I thought, no, that's kind of silly. Why would they do that? I thought, well, I'll just, might as well take a look at it and see. Maybe there's something inside that's kind of bad. Open up the front thing, look what I saw. Globalism, world religions, in the name of these children, and it was teaching these children that one thing that's very popular is that every religion worships the same God. In other words, the Christian prayer is just like the Japanese prayer, the Jewish prayer, and the Muslim prayer. And that we're all praying to the same God anyway. Matter of fact, they go in even the doctrinal things, how the Golden Rule was taught from all different aspects, the Roman gods and Confucius and the Egyptian Book of the Dead and all these different sources. So therefore, the message to the children is this. You are worshiping the same God that the Muslims worship. You worship the same God that the Chinese, when they worship Buddha, they're worshiping the same God. Because we're all going to the same place. It doesn't make any difference what you believe. Because when you die, we're all going to go to the same place anyway. And guess what, friend? That's what Buddha taught. That's what Confucians taught. That's what all those religions taught. But that's not what Jesus taught. Do you know that Jesus said very plainly that there are two paths and that the greater majority are going on a broad way to destruction and hell. And there's a narrow way that leads man into truth and the life. Now, White Lion is a new group that's currently touring the country. The last song on the album has a very interesting thing about when children cry. Now, I've went the long way around to bring you to this point tonight. We've talked about the Antichrist. Just barely scratched the surface. A man of peace. This man would declare that he has the answer and that the answer would be globalism. World dictatorship. One world religion, one world money, one world number, and the rest. Now we've been introduced, and I believe that Satan has used this to pave the way for the Antichrist. He's got open arms through the messages that all we need to do is just love everybody, forget our differences, forget all these negative thoughts that there could possibly be people that would go to hell if they didn't do it, you know, the Christian way, these closed-minded Christians. And let's just love everybody and be good and, you know, obey the Golden Rule and everything will be fine. Well, now listen what ends up coming from that concept in this newest group at the charts right now. It's called When the Children Cry.
Little child, you must show.
Must show a better day.
Because you were born.
For the world to see
that we all can live with love and
peace. That we can all live in love and peace.
No more presidents.
Listen, no more presidents.
And all the wars we'll end.
All the wars, universal peace.
One united world. Under God. When the children cry, let them know we try. Cause when the children sing,
listen,
then the new world begins.
When the children sing, then the new world begins. Now, let me just say something here. This is an organization called CAUSA. It's a group that says one united world under God. And you heard that line in that song if you were listening carefully. What's interesting, the man that backs this up believes that he has taken the place of Jesus Christ. He believes that Jesus ruined it when he died on the cross. Because he believes that Jesus was to live on and have children. So therefore, he believes that he is now the embodiment of Christ. And that he is married to the woman that he calls the Holy Spirit. And that him and the Holy Spirit have had sex, and they have now produced the man of peace. The person I'm talking about is Reverend Sun Young Moon. Isn't that interesting? By the way, these people who talk about the answer is loving one another and all this, listen again.
No more presidents.
No more presidents.
And all the wars will end.
All the wars will end.
One united world under God.
All right, let's just go back for a minute. What does this word say right here? Pride. What is the center letter in the word pride? I. What is the center letter in the word sin? I. And guess what the center letter is in the word Lucifer? I. You know why, friend? Because man's problem is his pride. Pride brought sin and caused the fall of Lucifer. And if you'll do a little study, you'll find out one thing, friend. That being who wanted to dethrone God said he could do it. And from that time on, the spirit of Antichrist has been the very backbone for every religious movement that says we can do it. I'm here to tell you, friend, your good deeds are not good enough. Your abilities are not good enough. And incidentally, this is a brand new album, just came out. Last Descendants, this just came out. Brand new album, just about 2 weeks old. One Nation Under God. And notice that that nation is not United States. That nation is not one particular one, but it is united of all these different major countries united together. But notice, he rides a white horse. And the man of peace has come to say, I have come to bring peace to the world and unite the world. You say, well, John, what could possibly be wrong with peace? Didn't Jesus come to bring peace? And as I close this service, everybody look up here, please, as I read this verse. Whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. But whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, the daughter against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes shall be they of his own household. Listen, friend, if you haven't listened to anything else I said, listen to this. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. He that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. And he that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that shall lose it, his life for my sake shall find it. You know, there's a lot of people going around the world trying to find themselves. And Jesus says you end up getting lost that way. And brother, what it all boils down to is this. Time is running out. The ends of the world are upon us. The scripture emphatically says that the last days would be marked by religious teachings that would deceive many, even to the point that even some of the very elect of God would be deceived. Now listen as I wrap this up. I told you a moment back that Jesus is not like every other religion. Jesus Christ and Christianity is different from every other religion, uniquely different than every one of them. Now I'm going to tell you the reason why. Now listen. In religion, name every religion you can name. In religion, man must do something to become better or be like God or become gods or be right with their gods. In many religions, you have to go through all the reincarnations. In some, you have to crawl so many feet and kiss things. And some, you got to eat certain kinds of foods and not eat certain kinds. And they go on and on and on and on. With all these things, you got to quote mantras and pray to different peoples and all different kinds of things. You got to do something to become right with God. But listen to me. But in Christianity, God did something for man and offers absolutely freely to man salvation. And it is illustrated above all in the scripture, John chapter 3, a scripture that I'm sure every one of you have heard. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Listen, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Friend, there's the difference, and the difference is seen in the cross, because it wasn't Buddha that died for man, or Krishna, or whoever, and it wasn't just merely a good man, but the Bible says it was God's only begotten Son who came and died. Once again, Jesus is front page material. Time magazine said last week's issue that this is the 16th time that Jesus Christ has appeared on the front page of their magazine. This time it's to a country that says, God, we trust on our coins and dollar bills, but very clearly states, not a biblical Jesus, but a man who was confused about his own divinity, a man who really didn't want to die, but decided he would go ahead and go through it, not for man's sins, but for his own, according to the movie. I'm gonna read something to you. More than 1900 years ago, there was a baby born in a stable in an obscure village. He was a child of a young peasant woman. His family had to flee the country with him because a king wanted to kill him. Even though he was raised in poverty in a small town, at the age of 12, he puzzled doctors and lawyers with his wisdom. He worked as a carpenter until he was 30 years old, and afterwards, he traveled only within 200-mile radius of his hometown, stopping long enough to talk and to listen to people and to minister where he could. He never married or owned a house. He never had a lot of money. He never did any of the things that we think accompanies greatness. He had no credentials but himself. He healed multitudes without medicine and made no charge for his service. A trail of miracles followed him, even the dead being brought back to life. He never wrote a book. And yet, perhaps all the libraries of the world could not hold the books that's been written about him. He never wrote a song, and yet he has furnished the themes for more songs than all the songwriters combined. He never founded a college, but all the schools put together cannot boast of having as many students. He never practiced psychiatry, and yet he's healed more broken hearts than all the doctors far and near. 3 years into his ministry, the tide of public opinion turned against him. He was betrayed by a close friend. Most of his other friends rejected him. And when he was arrested, very few wanted anything to do with him. After going through a mockery of a trial, he was unjustly condemned to death. And he was executed by the state, along with admitted thieves. While he was dying, his executioners gambled for his clothing. Others mocked him at his death. And only because a generous friend offered his own cemetery plot was there any place to bury him. But as he promised, 3 days later, he rose from the dead and came forth from the grave, proving he was indeed the Son of Almighty God. Many empires have come and gone since then, with rulers who have tried to deny his resurrection, to try to kill his followers, and to forbid his teaching, and even to blot out his name. But he still is the leading figure in the human race. The ultimate example of love, the names of past scientists and philosophers and entertainers and theologians have come and gone. But the name of this man multiplies more and more. And now it's no exaggeration to say But all the armies that's ever marched, all the navies that's ever set sail, all the rulers that have ever ruled, all the kings that have ever reigned on earth, all the many powerful people who have ever lived, all put together, have not affected the life of man like this one solitary life. Because he was not just a man, but he is the Messiah, the risen Son of God, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen? And friend, if you don't know him tonight, you're missing on the greatest thing that there is.